of the Faculty of Medicine, Colombo, and she is also a specialist pediatrician. Shalini has had a brilliant academic career, and she qualified from the Faculty of Medicine, JAFNA. The topic that she will speak to you today is a very important one, the prophylactic use of antibiotics. So now I will ask Shalini to do a presentation.
Thank you, Madam. The President of Medicine and Drug Committee of Sri Lanka Medical Association, the Secretary, Professor Pradeepa, and my first mentor, Dr. Anandaraja, and all those who are present here, very good afternoon to all of you. Before I start my actual topic, I would like to thank the Medicinal Drug Committee of the SLMA for inviting me to do this update. More than that, I also thank the audience who are present for coming for this lecture on a Friday, and mostly it is the last day of school. A lot of parents would be engaged in that, and I can see some students also here and taking your time to be here between 12 to 1 to listen something. It is worth speaking. But on the other hand, I am told that these lectures will be recorded and the link will be put on the SLMA website. So therefore, sometimes it is not necessary for people to be physically present here and waste some valuable time. Rather than when you feel very sleepy in the night, you can just click the link and you can listen to the topic if you really want it. So that's the introduction of this lecture. And the second thing, as you can look at this title, the unfortunate situation is this title is no man's baby. This is neither advanced treatment of myocardial infarction or the recent therapeutic update of how to manage esophageal varices, or it's not some new innovative antibacterial agents combining the old ones and saying it's a new one and funded by a pharmaceutical industry to bring people to listen. So compared to all those things, this is a very no man's baby topic. So the interest in this is not very popular. The second thing I want to tell of this topic is this prophylaxis. Because in medicine, especially in countries like Sri Lanka, developing countries, their laboratory investigations are not very quick and prompt. There is only a vague margin between prophylaxis and treatment. Where do you draw the line to say, this I am doing it for treatment, and where do you say to say this I am doing for prophylaxis? So there is only a vague margin between prophylaxis and treatment, especially in countries where there is no laboratory quick support. So third thing about this topic is there is no global consensus. So in order to prepare, in fact, I was told to do this topic about 10 months before, but I only prepared within last 1 week. But when I was reading, I found out that there is no global consensus between Australia or States or UK on one policy. So then imagine developing countries where we try to get trickling from various other places, that the coming into a consensus for a prophylactic use of antibiotics is really difficult. And the other thing that I want to say is, this particular topic is a bit of a tug of war between people who like prescriber to prescribe lot of antibacterial agents based on profit, and people who fight for rational use of antibiotics preventing antibacterial resistance. So it is a bit of a tug of war where there is no clear cut yes or no. So because of all those, this topic is a bit of a controversial topic, and they have selected the best person to do a controversial topic. If you all know me, I have been always being controversial in the 22-23 years I am in this part of the country. So that is the introduction. So let's look at the topic per se. So but because I was told that this handout will be uploaded in the SLA, please, I don't think you need to take photographs. Doctor, I don't think you need to take a photograph because it's going to come in the SLMA website. So there's no reason to take photographs. Am I correct?
Yes.
The entire handout is going to be uploaded in the SLMA website. So easy to read that rather than keeping in your phone and reading. So I just put some reading material I used in preparing this presentation, because even if I can't do the entire topic of prophylactic use of antibiotics, you all can go and read these things and learn more. So however, I relied heavily on the last two, because as you know, British National Formulary is updated every 6 months, and this therapeutic guidelines coming from Australia is an electronic one, so therefore they update very regularly, maybe once a month even. So when I was preparing my presentation, I heavily relied on the last two in order to tell you what the consensus is. But on the other hand, there are some other references which I have put here, which you can read later. So what do you mean by this prophylaxis? So prophylaxis is using an antibacterial agent in order to prevent an infection. But the problem here is, antibacterial agents are supposed to treat a condition. That is how we have been taught principles of antibacterial agents. Slide number one, they say antibacterial agents are for treatment. Avoid using them for prevention. Right? So that is what we were taught in the principle. As I always tell the students, there is no absolute in medicine. There is always exception. So therefore, as you can see, using antibacterial agents is probably rational in some exceptional conditions. And this lecture is all about that exceptional conditions where you would be using antibacterial agents before you know that the patient is having an infection, or in order to prevent an infection a patient is going to have. And it is considered as a primary prevention. Those who are trainees, especially if you have studied community medicine long before, you would have known there is called primary, secondary and tertiary, and now there is a primordial prevention also. So antibacterial agents used to prevent infection generally considered as a primary. And as you can see, you generally use just before or soon after an exposure to infection, that is the prophylactic use. And that can be classified into true chemoprophylaxis and preemptive suppression therapy. You can understand from the term itself, what do you mean by chemoprophylaxis, that is the true chemoprophylaxis, and the preemptive suppressive therapy. Even in malaria, we say that earlier. Nowadays, we don't speak much about anti-malarial drugs, but when we were studying, we have to study a lot. And what do you mean by true chemoprophylaxis is that you are administering an antibacterial agent to a healthy person, right, to prevent an infection for which you know that particular organism. You can guess it, what the organism is. And you generally know the susceptibility of that organism also. Do you understand that you know the bacteria and you know this bacteria is susceptible to this particular antibiotic, and it is a healthy person and you know the risk is there, then you target to prevent the infection. But the most important one is the second one, that is we call preemptive suppressive therapy. This person may not be very healthy. This person may be having some diseases like liver failure or renal failure, already sick, and maybe that he has been exposed to some form of infection which you are aware of, like varicella zoster or some form of meningococcal, that you know that. So then what you are trying to do is you don't label him as a healthy person because he has already got infected, you think so, though you have not documented. Now what you are trying to do is you don't want that infection to manifest as clinical features, or even if clinical features have manifested, you don't want him to get severe manifestation or complication of it. So you catch him or her, that is infection, early. So because you have not documented that there is a multiplying organism in the body, still you call that as preempting suppressive prophylaxis. Because you are not labeled him as a person who has multiplying organisms in the target site. So these are the two main types of prophylactic use of antibacterial agents. As you can see from this slide, first one is quite easy. You can have standard protocols for the first one. You can define, you can predict, you can say which antibiotic, that's easy. But the second one is a bit difficult. And it depends on country to country, place to place, sometimes hospital to hospital, sometimes prescriber to prescriber, sometimes patient to patient, and sometimes bacteria to bacteria. So that is a bit difficult. Then, for prophylactic use of antibacterial agent to be successful, what is the success? Patient don't get the infection. or severity is reduced. The ideal situation would be you should know what the organism. Second thing, you need to know for which drug that it is sensitive. Third thing is the risk period during which the patient would be exposed to an infection should be shorter. It should not be an unknown end. And the fourth thing is, if you can, you have to prescribe a narrow antibacterial agent which will attack only that particular organism. So why I have put this, it is a dream. Hardly we get ideal situation like that. That means that you know the organism, you know its susceptibility, you know the period of exposure, you can use a narrow spectrum antibacterial agent. It's a dream. But as the President of India said, that you need to have a dream if you want to get your dream materialized. So this is the ideal situation of a prophylactic use of antibiotic, which most probably all they are working in the hospital, sometimes ask me back, we have never seen a situation like that, we don't have this ideal situation. But what I'm trying to say is, that doesn't mean you didn't need to know them. So the best use of prophylactic antibiotic to be successful, that you need to have these conditions. So what they say is, if you know the period of exposure quite well, this is the period that the patient is at risk. And if you know that this is the particular organism which is going to infect this person, and if you know that this organism is uniformly susceptible to one particular antibacterial agent, doing prophylaxis is easy. This, because of the time constraint, I may not be able to do the entire list of conditions where prophylactic use of antibacterial agents are recommended. So therefore I thought, this is in, my students may know, each and every one of my lecture, I always put the principles. Because what I believe is, if you know the principles, even if you don't know the theory, subsequently when you know the theory, you will administer the principle. But without having the principles, if you only know the theory, you will know only that. You will be at a loss when you meet a similar incident in the future. So therefore I thought in the prophylactic use of antibiotics, I will tell you some principles of it so that you can apply it anywhere. You can apply it in medicine, you can apply it in surgery, you can apply it in obstetrics, you can apply it anywhere. So these indications are well documented. That means you cannot go and say, in my experience, this is an indication. So the indication for prophylactic antibacterial agents are well documented. The second one is irrational use. Because the term irrational comes itself, a clinical pharmacology in me wakes up. Right? Because we are so concerned about irrational use of antibacterial agents for the purpose of prophylaxis should be avoided. Right? Most of the upper respiratory tract infection, everyone thinks that there will be a bacterial infection. And then antibiotics are prescribed as a prophylactic use, which is not correct, which is irrational. Then the third one, this other clinical pharmacology term, where a lot of prescribers don't like it, right? Potential benefit must be weighed against the potential risk. You know, when you are reading these developed countries' guidelines, even giving one dose of antibiotic unindicated, they are writing to say, we always should think about the harmful effect of the antibiotic on the patient. We always should about adverse impact of using this one dose of antibiotic in this patient. But we have not got into that form of thinking. But the principle is that when you are trying to use it on a healthy person for the purpose of preventing something unknown, that you should always try to see whether that potential unknown benefit is worth for the potential unknown risk. Could you wait and to see for the evidence of early infection and treat would be better than doing an unknown benefit. So that's other principle. The duration, all of us know, should be kept short. And this I put exclamation mark, needs to start only few minutes before the exposure. So that is only possible when the exposure is in our hand, like a surgery. Other than that, would you be able to say, no, I'm going to now meet a meningococcal meningitis person now, so let me take a prophylaxis. You don't know that. So only place most of the time that you know is the procedures and the surgery where you plan and do, then you can give the antibacterial agent for prophylaxis few minutes before the exposure. So that if the bacteria reaches the circulation, the drug would be already there in the circulation. Then most of the times, it is the single antibacterial agent with favorable therapeutic index. Now you don't go and use a drug which has a 95% toxicity or which has a most of the drug interaction. So you always look for whether it has a favorable therapeutic index when you are selecting an antibiotic for prophylaxis. Because treatment is different. This is what I try to explain. When you treat the patient, we forget certain things because treatment needs that antibiotics. But when it comes to prophylaxis, there is something unknown target that we are trying to reach. For that, it is good that you know the risks are quite less. And the other one, most probably you know, for true chemoprophylaxis, that is for a healthy person, the dose of the antibacterial you generally use is lower than the dose of the antibacterial agent we use for treatment. The best example is this benzadine penicillin. So benzadine benzyl penicillin we give once in 3 weeks to prevent the beta hemolytic streptococcus. But if you really want to treat the beta hemolytic streptococcus, the purple bar is the conservation of the benzadine penicillin is not going to be enough at all. Because in prophylactic use, you catch the bacteria before it starts to multiply. So you can handle with low concentration of antibacterial agents. So as I told you, the clinical pharmacology in me prevents me to move without saying at least one word about irrational use of antibacterial agents. So there are only one slide on tell you what is irrational use of antibacterial agents. Is when you use an antibacterial agent, when there is little likelihood it will have a beneficial effect, or when the anticipated benefit is not worth the potential harm and the cost of the medicine, which we generally forget. Whether the benefit that we are offering is of all our potential, except the cost. Cost we know. Other than that, the benefit was a potential, the harm was a potential. So what you mean by irrational is, if there is no likelihood at all the drug is going to be beneficial, or in your calculation, if that beneficial effect is lower than the potential harm, then it means irrational. So in this forum, a request let me place to all the prescribers, we are running out of stock of antibacterial agents. So if we irrationally prescribe them for prophylaxis, at one point we may not be having antibacterial agents for rationally prescribing for treatment purposes. Right? So please remember that. So this is just I used to put for the students just to show that the generally everyone tried to think about benefit of the drugs. But the pharmacology, that is why we are very unpopular. Right, clinical pharmacology or pharmacology, we always try to think the both sides. It is the risk versus the benefit, and then the cost versus the effectiveness. Right? So these are the two terms, and if we believe it's not worth, then it is going to be an irrational prescription. So what are the potential benefits of using antibacterial agent for prophylaxis? All of us know. It will prevent a major infection. Sometimes it will prevent the complication of a minor infection. Sometimes the infection itself is minor, but then like your group B streptococcus pharyngitis, but the complication of that infection would be major. And the third thing is for immunocompromised patients, right? Their lifespan is prolonged because of this protective antibacterial agent. Recurrences of infections are prevented. Surgeries have become successful nowadays. The success rate of surgeries also depend on, I'm not telling you only depend on, also depend on this better use of antibacterial agents and containing epidermis. So if you really know that there is going to be an epidermic, then containing an epidermic will be helped by prophylactic use of antibiotics. Then when you look at the risk of the antibiotics, one is the resistance, one is the adverse drug reaction, cost of the therapy, and the misuse of the drugs. Antibiotic is the only group of drug. When you use it irrationally, the harm will be for many. All the the other group of drugs, when you are using irrationally, the harm is only for that single patient. But when it comes to antibiotics, it may harm me also. Right? Because of this development of antibacterial resistance. So now let's move on to the categories where chemoprophylaxis are recommended. I think this is a combination of British National Formulary and the Australian Electronic Therapeutic Guidelines. So let me put the categories, and after that I probably will speak only about few of them in little details. So number one, everyone know, to prevention of primary infection, rheumatic fever, still they are in developing countries. Even Australia, because of the Aboriginal population, they still have it in their guidelines. And in children, whoever who does some pediatrics, in recurrent urinary tract infection, especially if they have some structural abnormality which predispose to infection, there is a role for prophylactic antibiotic. Everyone knows about endocarditis, but the thinking has changed now. But when we were students, we were so careful about this endocarditis prophylaxis. But now the current thinking is different. I will speak about it. Then TB and malaria, I'm not speaking about those two because they are separate campaigns. But there is a role for chemoprophylaxis with isoniazid for TB, and also there is a suppressive preemptive prophylaxis in the case of malaria. Then prevention of acute exacerbation of chronic infection, certain conditions like bronchiolitis or cellulitis, there is a place for antibiotic prophylaxis for a short-term period. Then people know about this limiting the spread of meningitis. Then organ transplantation, because you may be putting him on the immunosuppressant. Then in AIDS patients, you already know the AIDS patient. Then endocarditis is said again. And also, these are the new ones, not new ones, these are the ones which I collected from various things. Animal and human bites, right? So there is an indication for prophylactic. I'm speaking about it a little later. Then again, neonatologies, pediatrics, you know, when the mother is at all exposed to group B streptococcus, there is a role for prophylaxis intrapartum. Then procedures and surgeries, I will come to that. So those are the broad categories, let me put again, where antibiotic chemoprophylaxis are indicated or recommended. So 4, 8 and 12. This is irrational. I thought I should tell that as well. Doctor, I told you not to take a photograph, right? So, it is going to come in SLN website. So, soon you click, it will come. So, irrational chemoprophylaxis, when you see that, the number one, the commonest one is the common cold, upper respiratory tract infection. Everyone is worried about a superadded secondary infection in a healthy, bubbly child even, right? Right, you just see two drops of common cold, two sneezing, no fever, but all of the prescribers are worried about the secondary bacterial infection. Why can't we wait until the first evidence of bacterial infection and treat? Because you may get it only a small proportion of people. So that is irrational. Second one is, it is coming again, long people who are on that, probably known to a lot of people. A lot of people are now in long-term catheters, so you don't need an antibacterial prophylaxis for that. Then prolonged labor, all newborns born to prolonged labor, if the mother is not at risk of group B streptococci, you really don't need the prophylaxis. And also these unconscious patients, comatose patients, that you really don't know whether you need a prophylaxis or not, because people claim the secretions are accumulated, secretion has a chance of getting it infected, but what they suggest is to you suck out the secretions, you wait for the first evidence of infection, then start the treatment. So now, whenever you read the formularies or the guidelines, they classify the prophylaxis mainly into three. Surgical, medical, and they have kept endocarditis separately. For reason, because it will be medical and surgical, and also because it is some of the important thing which has been into our brain for a long time. So therefore, if you read the BNF, if you read the electronic therapeutic guidelines, if you read anything, even our national guidelines, which I have put earlier, they categorize this chemoprophylaxis into three: medical, surgical and endocarditis. So let's see example of medical, which I had told earlier, the broad categories. So these are the main examples of medical indications for prophylaxis. I think all of them I told earlier also. rheumatic fever, meningitis, human or animal bite, early onset of neonatal infection. The next one I didn't tell earlier, that is especially children with asplenia or hyposplenia following a splenectomy or sickle cell disease, and also prevention of infection in patients with cirrhosis. Lot of evidence is coming up. Ceftriaxone is considered now to improve the mortality. Then post-sexual assault, another one is the in obstetric patients. Let me come few of them again. So this is one, because I'm not going to put what is the antibiotic for all those indications, but this is because of the very easy thing. So let me first tell you about prevention of secondary case of meningitis. So out of the common three organism, Haemophilus influenzae, Neisseria meningitidis, and your Streptococcus pneumoniae, for Neisseria meningitidis and Haemophilus influenzae, that there is a role for secondary cases prophylaxis by using antibacterial agents. And the choice of antibacterial agents are given here. Because these slides are going to come up in the website, I am putting the dose also. Otherwise, you can easily refer any of the formulary now is in your mobile phones for you to know the doses. But because it is coming in the website, I thought people can refer the dose also from there. So the doses are given, and as you can see, it is very short duration, 2 days or 1 day, depending on the elimination half-life of the antibacterial agent. So ciprofloxacin, rifampicin, and ceftriaxone. And for Haemophilus influenzae, again, it is rifampicin and ceftriaxone. But what I want to say is what I have put it in the bottom down, because those are the things which are neglected. So number one is ceftriaxone is a very painful injection. So when you are giving, if you are going to give IU, like for treatment, generally we go 5-ino. And it's a patient, no? So patient bearing pain to get his disease treated, there's a little bit acceptance. But for prevention, trying to hurt the patient is not very much accepted. So therefore, the recommendation is that you can reconstitute with lignocaine 1%. Right? It doesn't, damage the ceftriaxone. So that's one practical thing. Second practical thing is when you are giving rifampicin, please get a good drug history, because the rifampicin has a lot of drug interactions. Right? The famous oral contraceptive and drug interaction with rifampicin was taught to me when I was a therapeutic student. So all of you know it has a complicated drug interaction. So therefore you have to take a good drug history before you prescribe rifampicin. Third point is this pregnant woman, a lot of people ask, because both rifampicin and ciprofloxacin has a questionable safety. During pregnancy, ciprofloxacin is generally avoided. So then they say ceftriaxone is recommended for that. Then you have to use it with the lignocaine anyway. And also what you can see is in developed countries, they are very particular about whether it is licensed for that indication. Ceftriaxone is not licensed for the indication, but that doesn't mean you can't use it. You can use it. That doesn't mean is the industry has not done clinical trials on ceftriaxone in prevention of meningitis. The industry has not done it. So that then they don't have the license to use that. But the prescribers, if they have used it, if there are evidence coming from researchers done by individual investigators, then still it is allowed to use. And the next one is, there is a query, healthcare professionals. Because there is a panic sometimes when you really treat a meningococcal meningitis child or a patient, where the healthcare professional need prophylaxis. But when you read British National Formulary, what they say is, unless the healthcare professional is directly exposed to nasal secretions of the patient, and if the patient has not received the antibiotic for about 24 to 48 hours, then there is an indication. But if there is no direct contact with nasal secretions, or if the patient has been already on antibiotic for 24 to 48 hours, then healthcare professional doesn't need a prophylaxis. Then who needs the prophylaxis? So we, when I was a student, we get close contacts, and those close contacts are defined within this amount of diameter, living in the house or living in the preschool, all the things, how many hours they were exposed to this particular patient, all are defined. But now when you read the VNA, what the VNA says is, contact your local microbiologist or local epidemiological services. So as far as Sri Lanka is concerned, when you read the national guidelines, they have defined what you mean by the close contacts. So it is recommended only for this close contacts. Then the second one. This is, I don't know whether there are any surgical trainees here, but this is other important area. Prophylactic use of antibacterial agent in surgery. So what they say is you can use prophylactic antibacterial use in surgery for two types. Number one is when you are operating on an infected or on a site which is full of organisms. So example is the bowel surgery. The second one is, it may not be that infected, it may be even clean, but then a small infection in that particular site would lead to dangerous consequences. So all the cardiac things will come under that, right? Because you can't afford to take a chance. You can't just wait for the first manifestation of the infection because it's so important organs. So these are the two places where surgical prophylaxis is recommended. And the principles again for that, number one, there are clear indications, I will come to that. When you are selecting which antibiotic, you have to consider the patient factors, you have to consider the drug factors, mainly the pharmacokinetic factors of the drug, and also you need to consider the environmental factors, especially the ABSD pattern of the organism in your hospital. And the optimal timing of giving those antibacterial agents is within 15 to 30 minutes of your surgical incision. Can go up to 60. But if your drug needs a long infusion time, I think it is for probably vancomycin. If your drug needs a long infusion time, then of course you can start little earlier, about 120 or 2 hours before the surgical incision. Because if you don't time it well, then the purpose will not be achieved. So this is what I repeat to tell. If you are doing it, do correctly. Just then don't kill. If we go and give it about 45 minutes early, or if we give 1 minute earlier than the surgical incision, there is not going to be any usefulness. Then how many doses? The theoretically, most of the indication, one dose is enough. But if after giving it, if your 30 minutes is passed, say suppose you plan, you think 15 to 30 minutes of the incision I am giving an antibacterial agent, your maximum limit is 60 minutes, but due to some reason, electricity failure or some attendants were not available or something like that, if your surgery is delayed, or when you are operating, if the surgery is prolonged, then of course you can give a second dose. The second dose is given calculating 2 elimination half-life of the antibiotic. So now I know, I used to teach for MD pediatric trainees. So this half-life, pharmacokinetic, these are all, how do you call it, taboo words, right? So those are only for foundation module, you study and you pass that. After that, so please have, you don't need to memorize, no, you just have a note, or in your mobile phones, lot of these sticky notes are there, no? So in your sticky notes, just write and keep what is the plasma elimination half-life of the common prophylactic antibiotic you use. If you need the second dose, you need to give in 2 elimination half-life, because when it starts to drop, then you give the second dose. Then very rarely you may have to give another dose when the surgery is prolonged and if there is a large amount of blood loss. But what they say is more than 24 hours of giving prophylactic, mark the word, not for treatment, prophylactic antibiotic more than 24 hours is not necessary. Other one is about surgical prophylaxis. There can be a lot of other things you can do preoperatively. You can control the diabetes mellitus, you can improve the hygiene of the person, you can improve the nutrition of the person, and if you find Staphylococcus aureus, you can do decolonization before the patient is taken for surgery. So you can treat any minor infection which he already has. So if you do all those things, the chances of post-operative infection in addition to giving prophylactic antibiotic would be very minimal. And finally, what other indications are that you need avoid as much as possible using broad spectrum antibiotics. When I was reading Australian therapeutic guidelines, their antibiotic for surgical prophylaxis is first generation cephalosporin. Right? Now in Sri Lanka, a lot of people have forgotten the first generation cephalosporin, but for them, that's why I didn't put the drugs here for these slides, because I have left to the prescribers to decide what the drug is. But in Australia, they are using the first generation cephalosporin, which is not commonly used in other indication for prophylaxis due for surgery. And the last 16th point is very important. Infection due to lapses in surgical technique, operating theatre procedures, aseptic technique during and after operation cannot be prevented by using prophylactic antibiotic. That's another message we all have to take. Prophylactic antibiotic is given only the organism which may be coming out of the site that you are operating. But for all the other mistakes, that we cannot cover those mistakes, these iatrogenic mistakes, by way of giving prophylactic antibiotic. That we have to meet with the
therapeutic use of antibiotic, full course of treatment. Prophylactic will only cover the organism which may be released while doing surgery, because the site that you are doing surgery is a potential site of carrying organisms or a potential site of having an infection. Right. So these are the examples of the surgery that we need prophylactic antibiotic. So this is not a complete list, it will come up in the website. But what I want to say is, if you read our national guidelines and the 2008 NICE guidelines, they divide the surgery into four: clean surgery, clean contaminated surgery, and dirty surgery. I have given the examples, you can read that. The national guidelines will be more clear than this slide. And but only thing, the other recent developed countries are not putting this classification. It was only in the 2008 NICE guideline. So what they say about, even in clean surgery, if you think that there is a prosthetic material involved, then there is an indication for antibiotic prophylaxis, even if it is a clean surgery. But I have put it in the yellow highlight is that, even if it is clean surgery. But the last two, the contaminated and dirty, generally it is the treatment purpose of antibiotic, not prophylactic. So prophylaxis is generally for clean and clean contaminate, and in the clean, there are certain indications. So that's right. Then when I was preparing this presentation, I read these things, surgical prophylaxis. There's a very nice recent guideline from WHO, there's a 2016, and Center for Disease Control America is 2017, but what I found is there was no agreement in choice which antibacterial agents to be used. So therefore I also opted not to tell you which antibacterial agent to be used. What I suggest is that you need to read up, you need to look at our national guidelines, you need to speak to our local microbiologists, you need to discuss with the other surgeons in the hospital and come to a consensus. This is what the prophylactic use of antibiotic in our particular hospital for these indications. If anyone is there who does the surgery. Then the next one is very known, well known, is the rheumatic fever. Is still there. There are indications, as you know, why we give it, you know. That is because the complication of a minor infection is serious. And the drug still is the benzodiazepine, benzyl penicillin. And the dose, you know, it is little high dose for adults and a lower dose for children. And the duration, though we say 4 weeks, recommended duration is 3 weekly, especially if the patient is at high risk. And also the duration of this, if you are allergic to the penicillin, the recommendation is mainly erythromycin, because if the person doesn't like it, that you can use prophylaxis when you get the GI bleeding. Not all the time, they present it with the GI bleeding. The surgeon does the banding or whatever the, to do stop the bleeding. During that period, there is an indication to use antibacterial agents, and ceftriaxone is supposed to be improving the mortality. But on the other hand, these patients are also at risk of developing, as you call, spontaneous bacterial peritonitis. For that, the drugs are different, and for that, sometimes you have to use it for a longer duration, because that is sometimes primary prophylaxis. No, if the person continuously having ascites, there is a chance that ascitic fluid get infected. So sometimes you have to use it for a long time, this prophylaxis. So with that, I think this was my last slide. So I think I have time. This time is about 50 minutes and 30 seconds. So I think I have finished on time. So because there is only few minutes, I can just summarize what I said. So prophylactic use of antibiotic is a controversial topic, because the margin between prophylaxis and treatment is not very distinct. Then you have to take your decision based on the facts that what we have. And when you are using, it will be very good that if you know the duration of exposure where you had to give the antibiotic. But that's not possible except in condition where there is surgery or procedures. Then in the principles I use, that you try to use narrow spectrum antibacterial agents as much as possible. And also try to follow the guidelines, because everyone will be following the same. Then examples I put up, medical indication, surgical indication, and endocarditis. Under medical, I discussed about rheumatic fever, I discussed about cirrhosis, I discussed about hypersplenia, and I discussed about early neonatal sepsis and the human or animal bite. I also discussed about meningitis spread prevention. And then we discussed two important things. One is the surgical site infection prevention, other one is the endocarditis prevention. And if you remember at least this endocarditis prevention, now the indications are reduced to very low, and try to refer our national guidelines also. That's worth for spending this 1 hour with you. Thank you for being with me, and thank you.
I'm sure that Shalini will be happy to answer any questions that you all have. So if there are any questions, please ask. I just want to ask you, Shalini, you don't mention about doxycycline leptospirosis, because that's a national,
Because I have not put all the examples, yeah, madam, so I didn't use the doxycycline leptospirosis, but your national guidelines have under leptospirosis, not under prevention. So if you go and read the leptospirosis section, it is there. Unless they have immune compromise. Say suppose if it is a malignant person who is on anti-cancer drug where there is immune suppression is also there is indication. But other than that, they are clearly said, all the national guidelines, British national as well as the Australian one have said, for other person where you are using a urinary catheter, you don't need to put the prophylaxis. Same for surgery also, they say, just because you leave a drain in situ, there is no indication to use antibiotic prophylaxis unless there are some other indication. So it's not there.
Any other questions? Okay, so in the absence of any other questions, can we please acknowledge the speaker in the usual manner? Next therapeutic update will be in 2019, and we will let you know the topic.
In the SLME website, this handout will be uploaded. I think they are recording it also.
Yes.
So probably people who have not listened it can listen it as well. So next year we can run it in a small room, record it. No one need to come even, and it can come on the SLME website. Thank you for being here, all of you.